Hello and welcome to Chalk Talk. I'm your guest host this time with Dr. Mike Simpson.
It's kind of a role reversal.
Welcome to your own show. It's kind of a little different.
This is a little weird, but I ask you to sit in as we talk through some things, and I think you've done this maybe one other time.
I think this is my third guest appearance.
Third?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
I think I might be the leading guest on here.
Yeah, so far you are, and you know, I go back, I was just thinking before we started taping, the only time we've had to do a second take, it wasn't you.
Oh, phew, not yet.
It was Hetty.
Okay, well, really, Hetty? He's the constant pro, too.
Exactly. Yeah. It was really, really odd, but you know, that's the only time we've had to do a second take.
That's amazing. Well, luckily, the first take of start of school has been awesome.
It really has. The first day was just so smooth. It was kind of scary because you wonder what's getting ready to happen.
Yeah.
I attribute some of that to the fact that very few students changed buildings, and so the parents knew that what the procedures were for drop off, pick up, and everything else. We had a few transportation challenges that I'll get to in a little bit on some of the reasons why. But I think we've got a lot of that ironed out. You know, we kind of got everything where it was kind of smoothing out, and then the storms hit. And, you know, we had a lot of families that had been without power. I think most of them have gotten power back up now. And we're, as we tape this on a Friday, which that's why I'm not in a suit, we're thankful that most of our families have gotten power back up, and a lot of lives have been affected by that storm. But thankfully, no more damage, no further damage to the school than a couple of trees out at Cotterill, and looked like we came through pretty unscathed.
And really, the change is always different for everybody, and change is not always welcome with everybody, but with the neighborhood schools, centralized enrollment,
yeah,
everything seems to be coming into place a little bit, as you probably hopefully imagined.
Yeah, and you know, that centralized enrollment, that was pretty much a product of me going through as a parent myself with our daughter, and I went back to my office and I said, guys, we got to do something better.
Right.
This is too hard on parents. And so it's kind of evolved where it's now a one-stop shop for all of our students. We try every year. We have a little debrief on what we can do better, what we did well, and everything else, and try and make it better every year.
And what's really cool is the future. We just finished up the 2015 bond. Talk about the high school here in a second with that. Getting ready for the new bond, and here in a little bit we'll talk about even down the future. But it's nice here in Guthrie to actually be talking about the future, not 4 years, not 8 years, but down the line as well. But talk about wrapping up the first successful bond that was passed in 2015.
Well, we've been very fortunate. We were, all the projects, we've been able to save money on those projects and actually enhance the scope and make things better than what originally we had hope for. The heat and air at the high school, we were able to air condition two gyms in addition to that and replace the seating on the home side. We've leveraged some building fund money to also go in with that, along with the investment money that we've made for having that that cash on hand. We invest that so that we can that'll earn some interest, and we've used that interest as well to and with that we were able to put a new track in, the enhancement of the air conditioning, the two gyms, and then do a little bit of work on our gym at the junior high, new lighting, and sand the floor and get it nice and white, and it really looks good. And so we're real happy with all of the work we've been able to do. But as I walk through the high school, it's been so long coming with the heat and air problems that part of the building has had, that central part, and to see the teachers there, it's like they've been given an amazing gift.
Yeah.
You know, just to have quality air in the classrooms, and you can tell when you walk in those classrooms that the humidity is being removed, and it's just a much better environment for kids. And that's what we're really trying to do, is trying to improve the environment for our kids and our teachers.
And that's what was so nice about this, with that air conditioner on this bond that passed, because it had been on several several, I mean, this has been in the process for a long time.
Yeah, I think I look back and I think over the last 10 years have been on maybe three failed bond issues.
Yeah.
And we kept, you know, previous administrations and everyone had tried to keep bringing it back, but with everything else, it wasn't successful. And many times those bond issues were above 50%, but not at the required supermajority of 60%.
So now we, with the big latest bond that we passed in April, when can we start seeing the first signs of action?
Well, we're going to probably have next summer, we're going to try to get secure entrances to all of our school buildings so that you go into a vestibule and you're buzzed in so that people can't just walk into the building and go anywhere. And we've already got some technology money that we're deploying some new devices and some enhancements to the network in our buildings. And we got that already this summer, and we started to work on that. And so we're already seeing some of the fruits of the 2019 successful bond issue. And then as we go down the road, we've got auditorium seating at Fogarty, restroom work at Fogarty. We've had all kinds of trouble with the chiller at the junior high. That's slated for 2 years down the road. We're going to look at how we maybe can fast track that a little sooner. And maybe get that fixed, because we had a couple weeks without air conditioning to end the last year,
right.
And then we started this year with very haphazard air conditioning at the junior high.
Couple things you mentioned, the Fogarty Auditorium, that's important because multiple schools use that for their programs.
When we went to the neighborhood schools, we started moving all of the Christmas programs and things like that to the Fogarty Auditorium. There are about, I think they've lost about five rows of seats on the front as we take parts from the seats that are existing and use those to fix the ones that are back behind. And so hopefully we can increase the seating in there, make it better seating, more comfortable, and not, well, I tell the story of the first time I went to a performance in there, the seat I was sitting in broke. The people around me, some of them didn't know whether or not to laugh, or except for the person that was sitting right next to me that came with me, he was laughing like crazy. That would be Mr. Ogle.
I was about to guess Assistant Superintendent Ogle. It's kind of very similar to the high school gymnasium before the new seats. You had to replace that.
Yeah, we were doing that. We didn't gain seating at the high school gym, but that was largely in part because the seating that was in the high school gym was a little bit narrower than what we have now. We're able to expand that a little bit more and have our fans a lot more comfortable.
Awesome. And one other thing on this one, you talk about security, and I visit with a couple deputies, Logan County deputies and Guthrie police officers, and they're for school resource officers, but talking to them, they're having just as much fun as the kids are. They're like, kids look up to these deputies, these police officers, and one deputy said, he goes, if one opens up full time, I'm taking it.
Yeah. Well, we've given a serious commitment financially to make sure that our schools are safe. And we have the buildings that don't have a dedicated school resource officer, we're hiring off duty either officers from Guthrie Police Department or Logan County Sheriff's Office to try and staff that so that we have someone there. We've also added this fall a new entry system. It'll scan your ID, we'll run it through a background check, and it'll print off a visitor's badge that'll have your picture on it. And also, when you come to check your child in, if they've been like at the orthodontist or whatever, you'll check it in, and we will know who all is in the building at all times, and we have that on a spreadsheet. And so that's an added safety feature that we've added to all of our school buildings. And in fact, we probably need to publicize that more. As I checked my daughter in from her orthodontist appointment this week, I actually went through the system myself, and then the secretary went around and she showed me all the procedures and how we see who all is in the building.
Technology is an amazing thing, and the camera system, I think the courthouse copied you guys. The thing you can do with the cameras and look in, the quality of cameras.
Damon Devereaux, our county sheriff, he and I talked through a lot of it, and we showed him what our capabilities were, and some of the staff went with our IT staff to kind of look it over, and it's really good stuff, and stuff that we've been able to do with building fund and with bond issue money.
Yeah, and the momentum, I like to use the word momentum, when Guthrie Public Schools continues as you guys are able to acquire some land for future use, and what that might be, we might not know, but
38.4 acres of land that is just west of Brahms and Sonic, and on the over by I-35 and Highway 33, just north of Highway 33. Interesting piece of land, really, really intrigued me because there's also a part of it that it lends itself to accessibility. There is a railroad right-of-way that goes all the way, just a 100 feet wide stretch of land that goes all the way to the intersection of College and Pine. And so with that, it could provide an entryway to a school that otherwise might be somewhat, you know, hard to get through because the frontage of Highway 33 is in a floodplain. And so that's what really intrigued me and the school board as we reviewed that land. And then we went to the auction. We were able to purchase the land for $264,000. That's 38.4 acres of land for that. It was $267,000, I believe, for the land for 9 acres that was also sold at the same day that's between the sleep-in and Tractor Supply. Then when I look back at what Tractor Supply went for when they sold that land in 2016, it was $495,000. So we got a pretty good deal for what we had available.
And the land across from Tractor Supply was even more than that.
Correct. So. Yeah, and why there? That's a great question that I've seen some people on social media and things ask. One of the things that is a challenge with our community is finding land with infrastructure. And you know, we learned some lessons at Charter Oak. We knew that there was going to be some infrastructure needs, but we budgeted for that. But we invested almost $1 million worth of items just to provide infrastructure to support an elementary school. And that comes because there's no sewer system out in the county. And operating with the Rural Water District, they will not provide fire suppression water except in a tank. So we had to build a tank to provide that fire suppression. We had to build a lagoon. With this land, that's inside the city water district, inside where the city sewer will serve it. And we know that Oklahoma Natural Gas is right there as well. And so we have a lot of that infrastructure that is already available. So and there's not a lot of land inside the city water district to acquire. And at some point, we will need land to build a school. One of the reasons that I kind of alluded to this earlier, as we started school, we knew we were up numbers-wise, but we still are trying to put our finger on it for sure. But it looks like we're up around 100 to 120 students district-wide. And you know, as we grow, there's going to be a need to address that growth. And we're seeing that growth in South Logan County, but we're also seeing that in the growth potential in Guthrie, in the city limits, but also not necessarily in the Charter Oak District, but in the area east of town. There's a lot of residential growth potential there as well. And so we're trying to be prepared to do that. I always say I'd rather be proactive than reactive, yep. And that's what we're trying to do.
And you got a great deal, and a lot of housing additions going out on Highway 105, 33 is out there expanding as well. And just a comparison, Charter Oak sits on 25 acres.
25 acres, and a lot of that is, some of that's taken up with the lagoon, mm-hmm. which is not needed. We've got a lot of flexibility where it could be an elementary school. It doesn't have to be. It could be, it would be, if it were a high school, it'd be a little bit tight, but it's doable. Mm-hmm. But the thing is, we have that flexibility now.
Right.
And I know a lot of people thought, well, that's where the high school is going to be. None of that has been decided because, the chance that we'll be turning dirt out there, it's going to be a while,
right?
You know, because we have to pay off the debt for Charter Oak, and then we're committed to rebuilding Cotterill next.
You mentioned the land, the 38 acres out there on Highway 33 near I-35, $264,000. Tell us how that was funded and how that process works.
Sure. We used the building fund, similar to what we did when we purchased the land for Charter Oak, and we've been fortunate with the growth of the ad valorem property tax money. Our building fund has grown, and so we're able to have some flexibility there to purchase that. And so we use the building fund. You go to an auction. We had an executive session where we, the board and I, discussed this prior to going to the auction. And then I went to the auction and was a little bit nervous.
Do you do the secret yet?
I just kind of held up that card a little bit. We established some parameters on where the board and I were both comfortable financially with it, and this felt well within those parameters, so that we can have that flexibility coming down the road. We'll approve the full purchase on September 9th, and then closing dates, like I said earlier, is still set for September 17th.
Is it not exciting looking for the future, whatever that might be?
Yeah.
We don't know, but it's there's a plan, a process in action.
It is. It's exciting to see, because Guthrie Public Schools have been so starved for something like this.
Yeah.
And it's the community coming together. That's been the biggest change in outlook, is a positive outlook on what could happen, what we could do, and that positivity has just been contagious.
Yeah.
And it takes the community, it takes a team of people, and it takes holding everyone accountable and being transparent. And we've really worked toward that. And the thing that I've really enjoyed is as this has progressed, like you say, the momentum continues to build, and that's what's really exciting about what's going on.
Good time to own a Sonic. I know that Sonic out there.
Brian Billings has been generous to us, and that had nothing to do with our purchase, though.
Absolutely. That pickup line got a lot easier with Sonic next door, if it is a school one day. This is a fun time of the year. This couple weeks now into school, everyone's starting to settle in as well. Athletics, the band's going, the football team, cross country, softball. It's starting to get into the flow. A lot of excitement happening right now.
Families are getting back in routines.
Yes.
I know that we like that at our family. I'm sure the Evans household is the same way.
Wake up the snooze.
But having the student activities going on is and watching our kids compete and perform is just it's just so much fun. It's why we do this.
Yeah.
And I think with everything that we've got going on momentum-wise with the district, seeing our kids perform is just a lot of fun. I'm looking forward as we're taping this, it's the first home football game. Looking forward to that. Looking forward to as this year goes on, watching the personality of this senior class.
Yeah.
Too, and the things that they're going to accomplish and take with them for the rest of their lives, and how they mentor the underclassmen.
That's awesome. Appreciate the visit. It's your show. I don't know if you close this out or if I close this out.
Well, Chris, thanks for being the guest host. You've done an excellent job. I think we're going to be able to do this in one take, and maybe I'll have you back again.
We'll do it. Hedy, I can't believe it took you two times.
Thank you.
Thanks for watching. This is Chalk Talk with Mike Simpson.